Okay, so thank you for coming. I organized tonight's panel with a very acute concern for its context here in Israel today. I'm sure everyone is at least somewhat aware of the many recent lashes against artistic freedom over the past year in Israel. And I'm sure I don't need to remind you that our Minister of Culture is the former chief censor of the IDF and is on a mission to pass a bill in the Knesset called Freedom of Funding, a law that would prevent the funding of institutions who give a platform to anyone who wants to damage Israeli symbols. Even though the government's legal advisor said that the expression freedom of funding is not valid, that you can't select who to fund based on political stance, the power wielded by this office and the increasing examples of citizens who are calling for the removal of artwork at institutions is quite alarming. So, of course, we can very easily link these episodes to the fiery tinder that sparks the early onslaught of fascist or dictatorial regimes, but what we really need to look at is how these things happen in democratic societies rather than in totalitarian ones. And I want to focus tonight on the history of federal arts funding to individuals in the United States, especially the Individual Artist Grant Program of the NEA, the National Endowment for the Arts, which you can kind of parallel to the Israeli Ministry of Culture and Sport. And I want to preface by saying that the story I'm about to tell you is based on a book called Visionaries and Outcasts by Michael Brenson. It's Visionaries and Outcasts, the NEA Congress and the Place of the Visual Artist in America. Highly recommended book for anyone to purchase. So the NEA, as well as the NEH, the National Endowment for the Humanities, was founded in 1965 by President Lyndon Johnson, not by John F. Kennedy, as many people believe, but Johnson saw how Kennedy benefited from his support for the arts and gained him favor. And Lyndon Johnson was trying to get support from East Coast liberals for the Vietnam War, since he was about to deploy more troops to Vietnam. But he also had some understanding of how the arts were important in marketing the US after World War II. I'm sure a lot of people here in this room know or are familiar with the political dimensions of abstract expressionism and how this kind of modern art, which was reviled, abhorred before World War II, became a symbol of a new world led by the United States. It symbolized individuality and democracy. It was paraded around the world. International exhibitions were funded by the government, by the State Department, and showed the world a strong new America, one where freedom of speech was absolutely paramount and reigned, and where they let artists make artwork like this. These kinds of works, modern art really, is all about individual interpretation. It's what you see in the work. There's a lot of room for the viewer and her own subjectivity in interpreting these works. It's a very democratic art form. And we're talking about 1965. There's still traces of communist witch hunts in the 1950s, whose victims included many artists. But despite that, the rhetoric of the Cold War championed independence and free expressions as paramount American values. America was about anti-ideology, right? Complete freedom. And even though some artists were communists, artists generally epitomized the notion of individualism, of freedom, in a country whose national metaphor was that of the other, the outsider. It's a country that was built by pioneers, by cowboys, by Puritan renegades. And the artist was considered an outsider. The artist was an introspective person who was independent from mainstream life, who had a sensitivity and a spiritualism that was akin to religion and nature, but was independent of organized religion, meaning also that, therefore, they had no power. This is the kind of image of the artist, I would say, in the 1960s. It meant that the artist was built of a stronger moral fiber, answered to higher beings that befit a secular democratic nation. Because America was putting more and more emphasis on conformity and consumerism, the artist's estrangement from society was a condition of his or her integrity and insight. The 60s also saw a culture boom in the US, particularly mass media and popular culture, especially through TV and consumerism, and they realized that this was a massive, that this was really massive, and they worried about the moral fiber of the society. So the NEA was born, funding organizations in all of the arts and pioneering a very important grant program called the Individual Artist Grant Program. This was a separate program from the institutional funding, the museum funding. It gave artists grants directly to the artists through a peer review process. So artists would apply, and there would be a panel of other artists who would judge their work and who would award them grants. And these were really important grants. They're not just that this money, you know, made new work happen, let artists make new work. It was a major honor to be recognized by the federal government. It legitimized your work as an artist to your peers, to your Puritan parents. It was kind of proof that what you're doing is not a waste of time. This was a service to society. So these grants were a really big deal for about 30 years, but the Individual Artist Program was closed in 1995 under President Bill Clinton to much uproar and controversy. So why? What happened? Basically, over 30 years, you all know that the world changed radically. America changed radically. The world paradigm shifted in so many ways. First of all, the Cold War was over. There was no need for art as propaganda or art as branding. Commerce and the media were doing a much better job at asserting American, i.e. capitalist, values in a globalized world. But also beyond that, America didn't need to ask, they didn't need art as self-analysis or as a moral and cultural compass. They didn't need to ask if they're an okay society, if they're a moral society, if they're an ethical society, what are the dangers of the values of this society. And even if they did, artists are certainly not the ones to answer that question anymore, at least not in 1995. In the 60s, the artist was special, enlightened, led a meaningful moral life, and embodied humanitarian values. But the monopoly on values shifted to the growing Christian right. In the 1970s and 80s, there was a significant increase in the Christian fundamentalist movement, catered to by like-minded politicians. And of course, there's the market, the God of America. There was simply blind faith in the economy, in liberal economy, and also in technology and science that were no longer seen as menacing. There was no need to question them, no need to question the economy. And art itself was actually no longer separate from the economy. It wasn't pure, it was actually very much part of this giant, booming art market when works of art were sold for obscene prices. The image of the artist was no longer an idealist starving in a studio. These were rock stars in Soho lofts doing cocaine and selling artwork for crazy amounts of prices. And so began the battle over arts funding. In the US Senate, on May 18, 1989, Republican Senator Alphonse D'Amato dramatically ripped up a book with a photo of Andres Serrano's Piss Christ on the cover. He was joined by Senator Jesse Helms in publicly denouncing this work of art. We are talking about the infamous photograph of a crucifix submerged in the artist's urine. The work was shown in a group show of artists who were awarded grants from the Southeastern Center for Contemporary Art in North Carolina, which receives government funding from the NEA as an institution. Senators D'Amato and Helms didn't hear about this show by accident. A group called the American Family Association vehemently attacked the exhibition as immoral and anti-Christian. They sent out newsletters with names and addresses of congressmen, senators, and the NEA, urging people to demand the firing of NEA staff. Alongside this hysteria was another photography exhibition that was supposed to open on July 1st at the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, D.C. It was a large retrospective of Robert Mapplethorpe that was a touring show organized by the ICA in Philadelphia, which received $30,000 from the NEA to make this exhibition. Another politician in Congress, Dick Armey, sent a letter signed by over 100 congressmen denouncing grants for the Mapplethorpe and Serrano shows, threatening to circulate Mapplethorpe's catalog to fellow legislators in Congress prior to a House vote on the NEA funding. It didn't take long before 50 senators and 150 congressmen had contacted the NEA about its funding. The Mapplethorpe exhibition was canceled, and many artists and arts groups protested, lobbied, and formed anti-censorship organizations. The show was quickly put up instead at the Washington Project for the Arts. All these attacks intensified. All these attacks on the NEA intensified with politicians calling to cut their budget and insert new regulations that would limit or end NEA subcontracts to arts organizations, so demanding lots of changes to how the NEA was run. What until then was reserved for popular culture, like the American Family Association, the same organization, who protested against Martin Scorsese's film, The Last Temptation of Christ, a year before, or who protested against pornography, was now being directed at high art. The attack on the NEA was not done through trying to appoint conservative directors or a slow process of change. This was done very publicly through very brassy political campaigns. It came to performance artists, the famous NEA 4. So we're talking about performance art being debated on a national level in newspapers, in the government, Robert Mapplethorpe catalogs flying around through politicians. This was like a really big deal at the time. I'm sparing you all the details of what happened, but basically four artists, Karen Finley, Tom Miller, John Fleck, and Holly Hughes, had their grants from the NEA vetoed in 1990 by the NEA's new director, John Fraunmeier, after they passed the peer review process. So they passed the jury, and they were vetoed by the director. I'm sure this sounds familiar to a lot of people here. By the way, this happened after Congress amended the statute governing federal, like the law, to include considerations, quote, of general standards of decency and respect for the diverse beliefs of the American public. The artist sued the NEA, and the battle reached the Supreme Court. In 1993, in a partial settlement out of court, the NEA agreed to pay the four artists sums equal to the amounts of the grants that they'd been revoked. The artists accepted the funds, but continued to litigate against the so-called decency clause, arguing that it was unconstitutional and violated the First Amendment, the free speech. They asserted that their work was being defunded for political, not for artistic reasons. A little bit after that, in 1994, the Republican Party won midterm elections and gained seats in Congress and the Senate. Power shifted to Republicans even though Clinton was president. It's kind of similar, somebody remembers a few years ago under Obama. House Speaker Newt Gingrich called for the abolition of the NEA and managed to dramatically cut its funding. Under all of this pressure, and there's a lot of details over it, the NEA stopped the individual artist program the next year. But the thing is that it was not the individual artist program that funded the Mapplethorpe and Serrano exhibitions, and it was institutional grants that were responsible for those shows and which remained completely intact. And the NEA 4 were actually awarded money from theater grants, not from the visual arts individual artist grant program. So clearly, politicians zeroed in on an easy and highly visible target, art. Or to be more precise, artists. It wasn't that America didn't want art, it didn't want artists. This was during the height of the AIDS crisis. Openly gay and lesbian artists were making work about their bodies, about their identities. They were challenging the norm, challenging standards. The NEA discontinued its individual artist program with the rationale that the system would let funding trickle down to artists. This move continued the trend towards both institutionalization and privatization. The private sector was the answer, and in fact, this book that I just mentioned, this is an entire study that was funded by the Andy Warhol Foundation, which filled in, basically, after the NEA started to suck. So, and still does, and the NEA remains a shell of its former self. I don't think I need to draw the line very far to speculate on our moment today here in Israel, but there are some major differences. Israel isn't founded on the notion of freedom. It's founded on its Jewish heritage and a somewhat different kind of colonialism than America. Freedom of speech is low on our list of priorities when it comes to a national constitution. It's not that the arts weren't absolutely instrumental in shaping the Zionist narrative as the kind of story or the shaping of the citizen's identity took shape. And it's not that they're not needed now, especially with the many examples of critical artwork and critical films that are being actively promoted internationally in the name of our very special brand of democracy. But these are so obviously part of another national debate, and we need to look at the seams of that up close, here under our very noses. The veiling of censorship through the notion of public money is the cornerstone of this debate, right? You can do whatever you want, just don't use public funds. Don't show it in a public institution. You can be gay, just keep it in the bedroom, we don't want to see it. You can believe whatever you want, just don't put it in our textbooks in schools. You can have abortions, we just don't want to pay for it with public money. You know, all these arguments that we know very, very clearly. We know these arguments. You know, you can eat whatever you want, we just won't put a kosher stamp on it. We can't let ourselves get confused by this kind of rhetoric. Now, you can argue that America is not much worse off without the individual artist grants. And unfortunately, I don't have time to draw out all of how these grants were actually very important, and how the visual arts ecosystem in the US has changed as a result, becoming more fragmented, more heavily relying on public funding, which is often sporadic and unreliable. But I think it's enough to look here in Israel on what a prize from the Minister of Culture, for example, can mean symbolically, if nothing else. I'm not talking about financially here. And how the conversations are being shaped by vying interests and powers. So I'm going to end here, and we can keep talking about this after.
So I'm going to speak about censorship in political and journalistic terms, which is the field I come from, and I'm going to relate. And my basic claim is that censorship is it's not a new claim. Censorship is not a tool that is meant to withhold information to make something, you know, to make the public debate more empty of information, but it's a creative tool that helps create narratives. And I'm going to try and demonstrate it to two cases from recent years, from Israeli political and geopolitical debate. One of them is the attack on the Mavi Marmara, which was also referred to here in the exhibition, and the other one is the opacity policy surrounding the Israeli nuclear program. First, a note on terms. We should distinguish, we throw the word censorship very loosely around in the debate, especially on the political margins and on the fringe. And I think we should be precise. We should first make a distinction between censorship as the institution in Israel. The full name is the military censor, which is a formal institution which operates under specific guidelines and laws. And the idea of censorship, the action, the removal or the blocking of information from public debate or from any other institution. The third element, which is way more complicated, is the even more popular notion of self-censorship, which I might get to and might not. We'll see on the time. The second remark before we begin that I should make is that the conversation on censorship is a censored conversation. Because the first thing you know if you operate with the censorship is that the first piece of information that needs to be left out is the action of censorship. Meaning that if you submit your piece to the military censor, or if you receive a gag order from the courts, which is a whole different procedure from a different institution, the gag order would say that the existence of the gag order is not to be published as well. And the military censor will also not allow you, when he or she, in our case, deletes parts of the piece, the act or the missing pieces, you are not allowed to leave blanks. You should give your stories, your readers, a full coherent narrative and not show them the blanks or even advise them that an act of censorship was performed on this piece, which leads to the notion, to many notions. Anyone interprets the pieces the way he or she wants. You could hear people on the street saying that information is being provided too freely to the public, while you can hear other people ranting that Israel is a military state and you cannot publish. And it's impossible, and that's the most significant thing, it's impossible to distinguish between a piece which was censored and a piece which wasn't censored. Even the absence of a piece which was completely removed, and those are very rare cases when a whole piece is not allowed for publication, even this act is something you wouldn't know of, but in very extreme cases. And this is very important for when we discuss the creation of new narrative, because narrative, in order to be effective, and this is not new as well, should be uninterrupted or had some sort of a flow to it. And if the reader become too conscious of the story that's being told, of the narrative, then the act of the storytelling is being is not as effective as it should be, especially in politics. So I like to give two examples which I think were very successful on behalf of Israel, although, again, the public perception sees them most of the time as unsuccessful. I want to demonstrate. So we'll start with the Mavi Marmara, the incidents of the military raid on a flotilla that was headed to the shores of Gaza in 2010. But the story of the Mavi Marmara should begin actually in the Second Lebanon War, where it was perceived as failure by the military and the public. But the military had a different understanding of the failure. Part of the failure, and if you read the interviews with the former army spokesperson Aviv Nayau, who's a key figure in the new function of the censorship and of the spokesman act in Israel, so Avi Nayal refers to that part of the problem in the Second Lebanon War was that the army and the politicians lost grip of the narrative. The narrative was out of their control. The narrative of failure took over as the war prolonged, with Israelis suddenly, if you remember, trusting more the El Manar broadcast of Hassan Nasrallah's speeches than they trusted their own leadership, looking for bits of information outside. But not only that, but also compiling them into their own narrative of what happened. Like everyone, as the army now rents, everyone in the street had an opinion as people were fighting about the way the war is being performed. So the problem, the censorship problem in the eyes of the military, the censorship problem in Second Lebanon War was not what we think, that people, that the press printed that this division is going from the south and this division is going north, or that this missile hit there or there. The problem was a problem of narrative. And this led to a very aggressive policy of censorship and recreation of narrative by the army, which is still the main political institution in Israeli society, ever since the Second Lebanon War, in the first and second Gaza War, but also very clearly in the Mavi Marmara incident. Before the IDF planned the raid, there's actually a reference to that on the exhibition, there was a lot of thinking given to the issue of image, of control of media, of censorship, even legal thinking, in the sense of what kind of messages can we block and what kind of transmission should we allow from the ship. And the first thing the IDF did was to enact, I'm not sure of the English term, but a blockade of information, meaning that it prevented any signals coming out from the ships. And when the raid started, before dawn, and from that moment on, there's a concentrated effort by the army to create a space, like an empty space out of which the new narrative could emerge. How did that happen? First, there was a blockade of all transmission from the ships, what we saw in the morning news, which just a few of the first shots that were able to be transmitted just as the soldiers were boarding the ship. But more importantly, all the media that was created on the ship was confiscated as the people were arrested. And that happened really, really fast, meaning that it was planned in advance. And we have testimonies of activists that were on the ship that they're being strip searched and very effectively for media that either stills or videos which they took on the ship. Meaning that in the hours after the raid, when it was clear that something went wrong on the raid, we had no visual information. We only had a few oral testimonies, some of them from the people surrounding the ship, but since most of them were in custody, then most of the oral testimonies were from politicians and the IDF itself, and we had no images. Now, days pass, and the story of the Mavi Marmara becomes a big incident. You know, 10 people died on the ship. Actually, 9 died, and the 10th person died a year ago. He was in coma since the attack, and he died in hospital. So 10 people died on the ship, and the attack happened outside the Israeli territorial water, if you want, exterritoria, both in the term of the image and in the term of the space. There is an international controversy of first what to interrupt, what to understand from the event, who's to blame for the event, but even more so on what exactly happened there. Now, if you ask people what happened there, most people don't know, and they still don't know. Because that was not for the lack of information. It was because information was withheld from the public. After the first day, the IDF started releasing information. And this is where the end of the censorship, the act of the censorship becomes an act of reconstructing the narrative. Out of the many, many, many hours and still photographs that were captured on the ship, and the Marmara itself had hundreds of people on it, and if you know the activist circles, everyone is documenting. Is documentarist in the activist circles. Like, if people are not with a camera, they'll still, you know, use their cell phones or whatever to document every event. So there were hours and hours of documentation produced on this ship. But the army released very, very short clips. In total, over a period of several months, only 20 of them were released. And those clips had all sorts of special effects into them. The action was slowed in order to highlight a specific detail. Sometimes there were subtitles added to them. There was things were circled or an arrow showing the viewer what to see. Maybe we should watch one of those clips. You know, the most famous one. How do I do it? Это Кацал. Yeah. So that's maybe the most famous film that is still screened whenever there's a reference to the Mavi Marmara. So you can see this is the attack on the soldiers that go from the road, but you can also see that soon the clip will show all sorts of writing and effects. And all that. And the entire clip is 1 minute and 2 seconds. And that was screened again and again and again in Israeli television, along with a few more of these clips. Creating an image where, as you could see in this clip, helpless soldiers were attacked by a mob. Now, I don't say that that this image is wrong, but many other things happened simultaneously on the ship and around it. For example, we know now that the ship was surrounded with other army ships that were trying to board it. And at a certain stage, there were claims by activists that there were shot fired from boats around the ship and from the helicopters on the people on the ship itself. The second thing we know, which is not in this clip, that three soldiers were taken captive during the raid, held inside the ship, and later there was an IDF attempt to rescue them. We also know that 10 people died. We don't see that in any of the clips that the army released. There are claims by the medics who examined them in Turkey that some of the shots were execution-style shots from close range to the head. The army claimed that it only used 70 live bullets in the raid itself, but the number of the casualty, only on the people themselves, there were like 30 shots on the bodies, and there were also dozens of injured people. So the numbers don't really add up. But we don't see this action, and that's something very important. Now, there's also an element of the feel that you get from those far distance night vision camera. The only shift, the only disruption in this narrative created by the army happened several weeks later, or days or weeks, I don't remember exactly, when it turned out that one of the documentarists on the ship was able to smuggle a full media card. And she posted it on the internet. And when you look at the films there, unfortunately she wasn't, wait a second, she wasn't on the top deck where the actual battle took place. But when you look at this hour-long image, at this hour-long clip, it looks very, very different from the kind of feel that you get from the clips the army released. It's available on YouTube, but the action starts somewhere here. You can see the army boats here trying to board. You can hear shots all the time in the background. Here are the commando vessels around. You can see the people walking around. You can see later on the wounded are being treated. Okay. Where is the wounded part? Of course, there's a very humanizing effect to this long clip because you see the action from the point of view of the people in the ship, which are unarmed and surrounded by the region's strongest military. Imagine what would have been the perception if we had all the images that were held on that were taken from the Mavi Marmara. There were also small side stories of political manipulations in the way the clips were released to the Israeli public. For example, if you remember the clip of Hanin Zuabi arguing with the soldiers, this made some headways in the Israeli media. It was released on the morning that Chief of Staff Gabi Ashkenazi was to testify before the Turkel committee that investigated. So the public attention shifted immediately from the Chief of Staff giving an appearance on the committee that investigated the event to Khanin Zuabi and confronting IDF soldiers and all that comes with it. So that's the Mavi Marmara. Do I have a few more minutes to reach the opacity issue? That's the Mavi Marmara, and I think the Mavi Marmara, again, I'll go down, going back to the exhibition and to the quotes that Ruti and Maayan bring from a Knesset hearing. It's on the left side of the wall on the second floor. There are quotes from a Knesset hearing on the issue, on the raid, and they all deal with the sort of propaganda failure of the first day. Why the army didn't release more material in the first day to take control of the narrative. But I think the army was way smarter than the politicians on that. The army created this space on the first day where it could re-engage with the public, with a new narrative, a narrative that serves it better. And you can see in hindsight that except for the relations with Turkey, which were completely broken, not the political level, nor the army, the heads of the army, nor Israel as a whole paid a price for an incident which on face value raises a lot of questions. International water, unarmed activists, the fact that the army was forced to use so much violence and so on. Now I want to look at the different, we can turn on the light, there are no more clips. I want to look at another field of censorship in Israel, which is the censorship around the nuclear weapon. And I think this is the most important, if people are asking what aspect of political life is totally censored, then the immediate answer is always the nuclear weapon. The military censor, the courts, they are very, very aggressive when it comes to upholding the censorship on military, on issue of nuclear weapons. I will tell a tiny funny incident how the absurdity of it gets. I think 10 years ago, Tom Segev released the book 1967, a research on the war and the moves that are leading to it, and he submitted the book to the military censor, and the military censor removed various sections that had to do with the nuclear issue. But a day or two before the launch of the book at the Books Week in the spring, which is the biggest time to release books in Israel, it was discovered that the military censor left out a single sentence which was supposed to be removed. The sentence is it refers to the nomination of Moshe Dayan as Minister of Defense in the Israel, in the Ishkol government just before the war, and it says that Dayan, while becoming the government, because it feared Dayan, removed some of Dayan's power before nominating him. Among them was the power to declare war and the power to... Now, the military censor saw that something wrong was written in this sentence, but Keter Publishing says to the military censor, we already submitted the book, you deleted what you needed to delete. And the military censor is threatening, and the books are printed and ready to be sold. The military censor threatening not to allow selling the book. So the solution that was found was that all the employees of Keter stayed up all night before the book launch, and they used Tippex to erase this sentence. So if you have the first edition copy, like I do in my house, and you hold the page in front of the light, you can see that Moshe Dayan was not allowed to authorize the use of nuclear weapons or unconventional weapons on his own. So this is an absurd moment because the military censor obviously knows that some people in Israel know how to handle a piece of Tippex. But and that goes against what I said at the beginning. This is a place where the act of censoring needed to be seen. Needed to be seen. In the nuclear issue, because of the weirdness of the policy of opacity, amimut, it's better to have censorship, which is viewed by the public, than to have nothing at all, either no information and no or free information. And to understand that, we need to understand nuclear weapons. The irony of nuclear weapons is that secret nuclear weapons are useless because there's an understanding that countries are not going to use nuclear weapons in wars, or there's no legitimacy for such use. Nuclear weapons serve as a weapon of deterrence. It means to prevent other nations from doing something to you, because they know they have you have nuclear weapon. But if they don't know you have nuclear weapon, then the whole point becomes useless. So we need to know about nuclear weapons. When Israel created the nuclear program in the 50s and the 60s, it was in the context of the Cold War. And Israel's allies, meaning the French and later on the Americans, could not afford allowing a client state introduce nuclear weapons into a most explosive, one of the most explosive areas during the Cold War. So the solution that was found was allowing Israel to go on with the nuclear program, but allowing also a space of deniability to all parties involved. And the form that this policy took is the form of opacity, meaning everybody knows Israel has nuclear weapons, nobody is allowed to speak about them. Example, how, to what degree we're not allowed? If I write on this paper, I know that Israel has 80 nuclear warheads, and I put the paper in my pocket, I could be arrested for unlawfully holding secret information. But if I write, according to a publication in The Guardian, Israel has 80 nuclear warheads, the censorship would not do that because the censorship knows that it cannot prevent the flow of information from outside. And it even benefits from the flow of information from outside. Meaning, the fact that the Sunday Times or The Guardian are writing about the nukes serves Israel in the sense of deterrence, but we cannot discuss it because it hurts the policy of opacity. The opacity is being upheld so aggressively that the few people that dare to challenge it suffered enormous repercussions. We all know the case of Mordechai Vanunu, one of the only Israelis who served his entire sentence and was punished again after his release. And he's still under a condition like he was released on parole, where he served his entire sentence. But there are also other affairs, like the retired general, the Yatza affair, retired general who found himself in a prison for a full year at the age of 70 for thinking about writing a memoir in which he relates to some aspect of the nuclear issue, or the person who documented the policy of opacity, Professor Avner Cohen, who wrote a book about the history of opacity and couldn't go back to Israel for 10 years because he was under the threat of arrest. So the repercussions are enormous. But the result on the Israeli politics and Israeli history is also enormous. Because we constructed in our minds a history and politics which are freed of the fact that we have nuclear weapons. When we consider political problems, political issue, when we learn history, we simply leave a black hole in the issue of the nuclear weapons, or we don't even put it as part of the story. Example, the Six-Day War. There's a school of thought outside Israel in history that the Six-Day War should be seen in the context of the nuclear arm race, meaning that the Russians allowed a more free hand to the Egyptians and the Syrians because they knew Israel is becoming a nuclear threshold state. Meaning that what we thought was an issue of borders with Egypt might have been a part of the nuclear race of the Cold War. There's a famous book by Simon Hirsch, I don't remember the name, but I think Fox is Bats Over Dimona or something, And the names come from a famous Soviet mission above Dimona in the 60s, an aerial photography mission. We, of course, as Israelis, we don't think in those terms because we don't think about the nuclear issue. Again, Iran. Iran learned from the best, so they engage in a policy of opacity as well when developing their nuclear program. They actually go step by step by the Israeli manual. But we never think about the Iranian problem as part of the nuclear race in the Middle East. In fact, the Israeli Prime Minister goes abroad and says, we need to prevent a nuclear race in the Middle East. But the nuclear race exists in the Middle East because the biggest superpowers in the Middle East are engaged in a nuclear race already. So our political judgment and our political understanding is considerably diminished. And it goes all the way to the fact that we don't understand how few countries hold nuclear weapons and what effect they have on their environment and many other issues. You know, Israel is part of a small club, I think 10 countries that hold nuclear weapons. And we're not a tiny member because the only two countries that hold like thousands of warheads are Russia and the United States. Israel is a figure of between 80 and 400, according to foreign sources. It's actually very close to the Chinese that hold 200 warheads, and it's more than India and Pakistan and North Korea. We don't understand issues of our nuclear trade. Now we know that Israel sold nuclear knowledge and plans to apartheid South Africa. But at the time, did we know that? Of course not. And we don't know environmental issue. Of course, Channel 2 had to petition to the Supreme Court to publish the fact that the government was distributing anti-radiation pills in Dimona. So all these issues are outside our knowledge, yet we feel that we have a complete picture of the geopolitical actions of our government. We don't see the black hole. We created a new narrative. I think I'll stop here, and maybe in the panel we'll go back to all the various actions of censorship which I wanted to discuss. So thank you.
Okay. So thanks a lot for having me here, to Maayan and Ruti and Hen and Sergio and the CCA. So I will change the topic and go to another direction because I use another kind of censorship or the notion of censorship, but I will come back to that later. So, let's see. This rather cryptic quote of Arendt refers to the great importance of human affairs as well as to the boundless of action for establishing relationships that make the political existence of people possible. Maybe I will give you a short moment to read it. So my paper seeks to underline, on the one hand, agonistic confrontation as a philosophical and political concept related to Hannah Arendt's and Chantal Mouffe's thought. On the other hand, I'm willing to show how art practices, which address neurologic issues of hegemonic politics on the part of the public state power, can contribute in creating a conflictive or agonistic debate in the public sphere. Though I'm not considering the public sphere as a homogeneous political or social sphere, but rather as a multiplicity of confrontational concepts of becoming public. Needless to say that I'm particularly interested in art practices which seek to debunk institutional power relations or provoke agonistic confrontations. Eventually, the last part of my lecture takes up with the inquiry and sets out concretely case of censorship which related to art projects. So, now what brings Arendt's and Mouffe's thoughts on agonistic democracy very close is that they both agree on the following point. Namely, both agree that the denial of political confrontation or an aversion towards conflict, whether as agon, Arendt, sorry for that. I skipped to the next page. This happened really not go. Okay, so I go from the beginning. I will start by giving a short introduction of the agonistic approach in political philosophy. The term agon, from Greek agon, means struggle or competition. The agonistic tendency is present throughout the history of Western political thought. It is originated from the agonal competition in the Athenian democracy. It sparks and Nietzsche's ideal of the heroic agonal culture. It occurs in the concept of the aristocratic liberalism by Jacob Burckhardt. The terms agon and agonism have been crucial for the philosophical tradition of modern liberalism and are particularly linked to democratic theory. So the agonistic approach characterizes the writings of Hannah Arendt, Sela Benhavid, Bonnie Honig, and Chantal Mouffe, for the contrast among their concepts of agonism is distinguishable. I will focus on the agonistic concepts of Arendt and Mouffe, which are profoundly in contrast but also related to each other when it comes to the notion of agonistic democracy. The agonal spirit, in Arendt's sense, referred to the Athenian democracy, the polis. As Arendt writes in The Human Condition, the agonal spirit is the passionate drive to show oneself in measuring up against others. So the agonal competition among different opinions, doxa, underlines the concept of liberal state politics. Arendt's concept of agonality is one of the principles of political organization of the polis and sets the foundation of an agonistic democracy. Agonism is likewise the core political action in Mouffe's concept of agonist politics. But in order to clarify what Chantal Mouffe means by agonistic politics, we have to take into account the key concepts antagonism and hegemony elaborated in her early work, Hegemony and Social Strategy, co-written with Ernesto Laclau, and her books, The Democratic Paradox and On the Political. In the latter, Mouffe unfolds her understanding of antagonistic dimension, which is inherent to the society. Hence, she proposes that the notion of conflict in democratic societies should not be an antagonistic, but an agonistic one. That means that the conflict itself is not a struggle between enemies, in Carl Smith's sense, this is antagonism, but a struggle between adversaries, which is agonism. So for Mouffe, agonism is the conflict among political opponents, which is finally what constitutes a well-functioning pluralistic democracy. So now I move like to the correct page. Mouffe with and versus Arendt. Now, what brings Arendt's and Mouffe's thoughts on agonistic democracy very close is that they both agree on the following point. Namely, both agree that the denial of political confrontation or an aversion towards conflict, whether as agon, Arendt, or agonism, Mouffe, would harm the democratic principle as such. Both Arendt and Mouffe argue that the normative criterion for the institution of agonistic democracy is the recognition of the regulated confrontation among different political concepts. Consequently, both political philosophers perceive public sphere, öffentlichkeit, as a category and as practice in political modernism which enable conflictive debates. But one could argue, therefore, that the liberal Mouffe seems to be very close to the traditional of the liberal democracy and pluralism. At the same time, and this proves the controversial elements in Mouffe's work, the Gramscian Mouffe is one of the main advocates of the hegemony discourse and of radical democratic theory. This is why, in the end, Mouffe defends a concept of agonistic democracy which contests the Arendtian one, although both concepts depart from the formation of a political we. Arendt puts a great emphasis on the plurality of different doxa and propagates the performative production of the collective will, which is the we within the political community. In Arendt's democratic model, this we is a multiplicity of perspectives capable to antagonize each other in a consensual way. Unlike this, Mouffe advocates the formation of a we against them. Following Smith's friend-enemy schema, Mouffe propagates a conflictive relationship between political adversaries. In her conception of agonistic pluralism, it is precisely this distinction between adversaries which constitutes the conflict. Hence, Mouffe's agonistic model of pluralism not only differs from the ideas of extreme pluralism, but it also puts the discursive rationality of liberalism, like for example the one of Habermas or Rawls, into question. This is to say that Mouffe's agonistic pluralism has limits and takes note of the certain differences which are constructed as relationships of subordination. Finally, what is at stake for Mouffe's political thought are the consequences of the current neoliberal hegemonic order. At the same time, her agonistic approach seeks to highlight radical left projects which could challenge the neoliberal political order on a social and cultural level. So now I move on to the art field. So as we have seen, the primary focus of the agonistic approach is to highlight conflict or conflictive dispute. But how do artistic positions contribute in highlighting conflict or even produce it? Certainly, there are plenty of examples in art history which deal with representation of conflict. For example, the work of Max Beckmann and George Grosz in the post-war period, and the photo collages Bringing the War Home, House Beautiful by Martha Rosler, or the anti-war posters of the Artist Poster Committee during the Vietnam War, but also the photography of Vesna Pavlovich in Belgrade under the Milosevic regime, can all be seen as counterparts relating to actual conflicts, like war, regime change, or protest. Further on, there is a plethora of contemporary artworks that seek to address actual conflicts in a political and at the same time poetic way. One could think here, for example, of Francis Ailey's work The Green Line, a performance through the municipality of Jerusalem, and another example would be Irrigation by Teresa Margolis. The latter is a video work that outlines the current violence in North Mexico, and the artist videotapes a water truck from behind on the road between Alpine and Marfa in Texas, as it dispenses 5,000 gallons of water that is mixed with blood, excrement, and other bodily matter that the artist collected from multiple sites of violence in Ciudad Juarez. So just as Ailes expends 58 liters of green paint for tracing a line following the 24-kilometer-long Green Line in Jerusalem, Margolis is wasting 5,000 gallons of water. Hence, both artistic interventions relate to the waste of human lives in territories of conflict. But all examples mentioned above refer more or less to a poetic, conceptual, or documentary representation of conflict. Whereas the art practices I'm going to unfold as next stand for an agonistic approach in which the conflictive moment occurs through the practice itself. So, unearthing a Nazi poet is an intervention initiated by the Vienna-based group Plattform Geschichtspolitik. Plattform History Politics is a self-organized group of art students, activists, and teachers who are affiliated with the Academy of Fine Arts Vienna. Unearthing a Nazi poem is an ongoing project which derives from a critical reflection on Austria's Nazi and fascist past. Vienna-born poet Josef Weinheber, whose bronze bust, as you see, stands at the Sillerplatz in front of the Fine Arts Academy in Vienna, has been a member of the Austrian National Socialist German Workers' Party, the NSDAP, and Hitler included him into his so-called Gott begnadeten Liste, as a God-blessed artist exempt list, and Weinheber is memorialized since then as an important intellectual figure of Vienna. So I move to the intervention. So on the 23rd of June in 2013, members of Plattform Geschichtspolitik, dressed as conservators, managed to unearth the foundation of the bronze bust. They dug a rolling ditch around the base of the monument, exposing its concrete foundation and altering the surrounding landscape. Afterwards, they naturalized the alteration by planting rolls of turf over the ditch. And 2 days after, the city gardeners filled in the ground again filled in the ground again by using the same turf that have been purchased for the intervention. But unlike the previous Weinheber interventions, also from Gesichtspolitik, which all fails the solidness of the city authorities, this last one has been broadly discussed and even approved by the Secretary of Culture. The interventions of Platform Geschichtspolitik had managed since 2009 to carry on a conflictive debate on the hegemonic structures related to politics of memorialization in Vienna. With its practice, Platform Geschichtspolitik not only provokes the city's strategy regarding historical monuments, but also stands for a critical art intervention in public space, which significantly differs from the drop sculpture tradition of what is generally called art in public space. In contrast, one could also claim that, let's say, looking into their practice from an art historic perspective, that this is a rather similar to Boyle's concept of social sculpture, because Platform Geschichtspolitik, the members of Platform Geschichtspolitik, call for actual changes. Just a small quote. In their words, we demand that the responsible city council create the necessary framework for the contextualization and artistic transformation of the monument. Finally, if we take into account that public monuments represent a political and aesthetical debate on writing history, it is eventually apparent that the debate on who is writing history and how must be an agonistic one. So I move on to image blockade, which you all know well. Spaces of actual conflict, self-censorship, public consciousness, and forms of population control can be seen as the crucial topics of Exterritory's work Image Blockade. The film addresses in the first place censorship as this being imposed both by institutional power mechanisms and by individuals themselves, so self-restraint. At the same time, censorship is being juxtaposed to the refusal of the 8,200 unit to serve in operations of illegal surveillance in Palestinian territories. In my view, I'll go back to the next one. Exterritory's recent work questions not only the relationship between censorship, law orders, and representation. I would also claim that their work challenges the formality of the epistemological gesture as such. Epistemology, which means understanding episteme, or theory of knowledge, is a central concern in Foucault's work. The study of Foucault's work on power and knowledge provides a critical view of episteme in regard to its truth and justification, for it reveals general assertions about the nature of truth and knowledge. For Foucault, there is a dyadic relationship between power and knowledge. He claims, I quote, that power and knowledge directly imply one other, end of quote. Foucault enforces the argument that power and knowledge are co-constituting, but this doesn't mean that knowledge conflates with power. Thus, he suggests that epistemology has always to question the relationship between politics and knowledge. So power and knowledge can be articulated in a way that begins to conceptualize knowledge neither as ideology nor as science. So the experiment shown in Image Blockade should be conceived in the first place as a professional scientific examination. But if we take into account that the artist inserted additional information into the interviews of the 8,200 military unit and the Israeli civilians that were interviewed, or part of the experiment, we are confronted with a phenomenon that I would like to call simulated science. Insofar, the parameters of the laboratory experiment are being contaminated by the invented information, it appears to me that their work also confronts the hegemonic capitulation of scientific reason as such. So I move on to the... maybe skip that. So in the last part of my lecture, I would like to bring up the issue of censorship and self-censorship in regard with politics of intolerance. But I'm not referring to the classical censorship politics or like state politics as you referred, for example, but I'm trying to bring up some examples that it's a little bit more smooth, or we can see if we can call it censorship or not. So I will therefore use two examples, the public art installation of Nezahit Ekici in Dresden and the theater piece Corpus Christi in Athens, which both faced sanctions caused by far nationalist aggressors. In the first case, the reaction catalyst is Islamophobia, whereas the second one relates to homophobia, racism, and fascism. So, Nezahit Ekici has been invited by the public art project Dresden, working with the city. This was in this year, 2015. Her installation, titled Post-it, consists of oriental carpets which form an arch in front of the district court of Dresden. Shortly after the installation was completed, the vandalism started. So, Shiti Islam was one of the first sprayed reactions against the piece. After several damages, the city authorities restored the installation without asking the permission, whether from the curator or from the artist. The latter actually refused to eliminate the aggressive interventions on her work for the sake of documentation and for reasons of remembering the reaction. Finally, Ekici agreed on exchanging the carpets covering the insulting sayings by new ones. On the exchange carpets, one could see the sprayed words, but not read them. It was kind of blurry. So, Ekici's installation has given rise to many public debates on Islamophobia or carpet phobia, as someone posted on the events page in social media. Ekici's work refers in the first place to an actual hearing of the 1st of July 2009 that took place in the district court in Dresden. It was the hearing of the murder case of the Egyptian Marwa El-Sabini. Because of wearing her headscarf, Marwa El-Sabini was abused as Islamist and terrorist and murdered by Alex Vins. But besides that fact, the works of Ekici addresses the newly founded racist and particularly Islamophobic movement Pegida, whose name means patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of the West, Abendland. Although being provocative in a straightforward sense, Ekici's public art piece hit the nerve of Dresden society. However, it is rather important to underline how the city authorities handled the vandalism of the installation. The city practiced what I would like to call a restorative censorship. It was actually a censorship of the commemoration, one that cuts up the potential for remembering the reactions that the work actually produced. So, and I'm moving on to the last example. Corpus Christi. This case of censorship that I'm going to present as next should be considered both as an example of censorship and right-wing actionism. The theater play Corpus Christi by the US playwright Terence McNally was performed at the Athenian Theater Hetaireo in October 2012. On the day of the premiere, theater director Laertes Vasiliou and his group Artisan were attacked by homophobic Christian Orthodox ultra-religious people. Backed by right-wing extremists, actually led by two deputies of the Golden Dawn neo-Nazi party in Greece, the fanatical demonstrators tried to enter the theater and stop the play. This quite heterogeneous group of angry demonstrators declared the theater group and the audience being present as of its enemy. Whereas the Greek police had been on the spot, not only couldn't avoid the violent attacks on the gathered audience, which mostly homosexual people, but in some cases they supported the right-wing malicious agitation. The spectators on site reported numerous verbal and physical violent attacks against them and the Albanian Greek director Vasiliou. Homophobic and racist statements were particularly in the agenda of the extreme right-wing group. So, a specific expression of the Golden Dawn MP Panayotaros, "fucking Albanian assholes, gaping fags," stands for the complexity of hate speech. I will open just a short parenthesis by reviewing the argument of Dimitris Papanikolaou on Corpus Christi. So Papanikolaou highlights the fact that the episode at Hetaerion was an indisputable demonstration of an assemblance among homophobia, nationalism, racism, and neo-Nazism. At the same time, Panagiotaros' phrase debunks a problematic position often shared among the left, which argues that fascists has been historically repressed homosexuals, and this is why they use intensively a homophobic and macho vocabulary. For this position actually approves that homosexuality is a pathogenic condition per se, and as such, it is perceived as an additional disorder within fascism. But let me continue just quickly on this remark by adding what followed after the opening night. So despite the daily turmoil in front of the theater, Vasiliou and Artisan continue their performance. After 3 weeks of agitations and the dispute in the courtrooms where the violation of their rights has been vindicated, Vasiliou and Artisan stopped the play. And they gave a statement, it is not a solution to go on as if nothing had ever happened here. Because what has happened is real nightmares and a great shame. And they continue, if a play raises fundamental questions such as the right to diversity and the freedom of expression, it means that the theater is present in real life. As a closing remark, I would like to make 3 points on this case of actual conflict. Firstly, the visibility of homosexuality that Corpus Christi put on stage was the trigger for an alleged orthodox heteronormative sexuality. Secondly, the conflict between the blaspheme artists and the ultra-religious groups was instrumentalized by the right-wing extremists for pushing their racist and homophobic beliefs. Therefore, we watched a tremendous demonstrative performance from the neo-Nazi group, which actually dominated on site, despite the solidarity from the audience to the theater artists. And thirdly, one could also claim that director Vasiliou and his group practiced a form of self-censorship when they decided to end the performance after 3 weeks. By ending my remark, I would like to highlight the fact that art practices can contribute in challenging relationships of institutional power. Just as image blockade addresses issues of the political terrain in Israel by debunking societal grievances in a subtle but conflictive way, so its platform Gesichtspolitik, Nezaket Egici, or the Artisan group doing in more or less depicted manner. Nevertheless, I'm not advocating that all critical art practices mentioned above contribute in the same way in creating an agonistic conflict. As a matter of fact, the departing points of the artists, as their methods and aesthetics, are quite different. The interdisciplinary experimental approach of Exterritory, the activistic intervention of platform Geschichtspolitik, and the straightforward provocation of Egici can be distinctively framed. Hence, by the examination of these examples within the societal and political context in which they appeared, we can deduce that critical responses related to dispositives of power can lead to agonistic confrontations. But in any case, one should be also aware of the fact that conflict can turn out to real antagonism, which seeks to diminish the democratic space of struggle. And this was, for example, Hetaerion, or Greece has a long history of censorship and other cases, but maybe I go on in the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, the three of you. I have lots of ideas and questions, and I'm trying to distance myself from our daily life here somehow, and not go directly into our fears and our thoughts about the direction where things are going. But still, I find it quite interesting that we could, or maybe I will try to put the three lectures together, because I was very interested when Hen mentioned of this polemics in the US as something going from the bottom up, which is something that we believe that it's not happening to us. We think that we are going to be censored, we are being censored from the top, like with our minister. But then Noam, with this, stressing this, the opacity, which I think that in a way is, if not midway, it's completely self-censorship. We see this this opacity flowing from the nuclear program to many, many things. Of course, the Marmara, but also all these attacks in Syria that happened. And I wonder if Israel as a country would have been able to maintain some opacity in an attack on Iran, we probably would have done it. I mean, the obvious moment where we couldn't do it and say someone else did it, it's probably what killed the idea. And it's going, and we see it all the time, but I do feel that it's maybe self-censorship that we are, that I imagine that when they say, okay, the Air Force attacked a convoy of arms in Syria, like happened just lately, I wonder if they are really going to the censorship to ask if they, when they know, when they really actually read it from the foreign newspapers, if they go and ask for permission or they just give it up. I mean, if this thing that we don't even bother because we can quote The Guardian, for instance, yeah? Mm-hmm. And again, just to finish, and I open this for you, is self-censorship part of our new culture? If it's when we have like internet, YouTube, everything, are we going to censor ourselves? And by censoring ourselves, I mean also like censoring each other, like in the words you showed in Dresden, that there was not something from above, there was censorship from right-wing fascists, we call them, that were censoring the work of art because they didn't like it. So it's not this censorship from the top, but from just people that believe they have to censor some other's work. So this is something I would like you to relate to, this kind of bottoms up and top to bottom and self censorship actually. So whoever wants to feel that wants to stop the same.
I'm very careful speaking about self-censorship because I have a tendency to accuse the entire world, everyone, on self-censorship, on not being bold enough or holding things back. But, you know, for me, coming from journalism, I think that everybody edits themselves all the time. So we do that. And I think that... for me, the focus was still on state power, and I think that it's very easy for us in the world that is dominated by virtual realities and virtual representations and the conversation that exists in a virtual space to put aside the mechanism of power, of like brute power that you meet. What interesting about the nuclear issue for me, what started it was that you met all these figures that were suddenly met with this power, with the power, the real power of censorship. And I think it's something, it's almost a shocking experience. I interviewed Avner Cohen, who wrote about opacity and about Israel and the bomb. And for me, this was the most telling experience. First, he began to tell his story. It was very important for him all along to say how patriot he was, how people in the nuclear field called to congratulate him for his work because he's their historian and all that. And he was always like shocked from the fact that the government really went after him. Like that if he could go back to Israel to visit his 80-year-old mother, he could get arrested at the airport. And the same thing for Yatsa, who was this old general who wrote his memoir, and suddenly was in prison for a full year. But I think this is where we should stop the conversation. I think there's we don't like to talk about real power, and we should stop there. But at the end, and that's also what's so fascinating about the nuclear issue, it does end with very rigorous self-censorship. And the fact that you know, I said at the beginning that you hear both complaints in Israel, that there is too much censorship and there's not enough censorship. But the truth is that you hear the latter more than you hear the former. Like, you hear most of the time from the public that there's not enough censorship. Or, you, as a journalist, you often hear people say, the papers print whatever they want, and they don't go to the censor. In all my career, I heard of one or two cases where it was clear for the paper that this piece needs to go to the censor, and that it didn't. Actually, what happens all the time is that way more material than the censor can handle is submitted to the censor. And I can tell from my experience, we started an independent site that's a non-profit. We're not part of the censorship arrangement. We're not obliged by the understanding between the censorship and the editor. So 2 weeks ago, we submitted the first piece for censorship voluntarily. And there was a big argument in the collective whether we'd do it or not. And the decision at the end was to submit it, knowing that they'll probably approve everything, and they approved everything. But the conversation wasn't very ideological, it was all risk management. Like, what would happen if?
So why did you decide to send something to the censorship?
Because I knew, if you read, you know, the censor, the head military censor just retired. And she gave a very long interview in Ein Spiegel, in a media watchdog. And it's fascinating. It's in a constant tension between her heading an institution that does not exist anywhere in the Western world, a military censor, army, responsible of the civilian press, and with the fact that she prides herself with that the censorship is considered the most liberal arm of the state monitoring of the media, which is true. Every journalist will tell you the censor is the best. The courts are the worst, the censor is the best. And I think that I was in favor of working with the censorship, and some of the editors were against it. And it was a very long debate on that. And I think I brought, like another editor who was for it, our experience in the press. Like, knowing that the risk of a controversy is enormous for a small project, that most likely will get the approval, and the willingness to A, print or publish what you want, and B, not suffer terrible consequences on something which is totally unplanned. And with doing that, we just gave up on the ideological idea of whether to submit or not. And I saw editors do this decision all along my career. So I think that, and we know that as an Israelis, and I'll finish with that there is an incredible moment where those few individuals like Vanunu are meeting what is like the boot of the power. And there's another incredible moment when you meet those people who internalized it completely, or when you meet it in yourself.
I don't know how to link myself, actually, because it's like I'm not familiar with the censorship cases in Israel. I mean, but for me, maybe it's like we have for sure two levels, like this state institutional power level, and then the second level is how people censor themselves, or how they get disciplined, somehow they are disciplined to do that. And I think in the art field we can see something like this, what kind of risks you can take. Also, coming back to your presentation, Hen, like, what do you represent with your artwork, or are you allowed to say that in which context and so on, or if your sponsors or your founders would pick you to represent their institution or the state or so. So it's like it's a double situation there. But I'm not sure. Maybe we can open it for the discussion.
Just to respond quickly to what you said, I think it's beyond that. I think it's beyond what you can say with your work, your images, your whatever expression. Mm-hmm. It's how somebody else can co-opt your work, your expression, or something like that for their goals. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of a, you know, I think there's a distinction there that's important to make. But yes, we should open it up to, and there's a microphone here that we will pass around.
Thank you. You've extended the notion of censorship to very different and interesting directions. And I wonder what is unifying them, taking maybe Sofia on the notion of agonal and antagonistic. I wonder if you are only describing different kinds of struggles in the public space, or actually control the public space, and it struggles because it's not actually agonal, it's antagonistic. It's a matter of struggle without having even polemic exchanges between the sides. So I wonder if there is some kind of unification, unified approaches to all three presentations, and whether you accept the fact that basically what you're presenting is some kind of public struggles. Sometimes it's against the regime, sometimes it's against other groups in the public.
I mean, it's a good question, actually, because for sure struggle is a very big term, and you can apply it like you have a struggle with a friend of yours. So struggle or conflict, we have to see it all the time in the context in which they appear. And for me, I think like censorship, I'm not sure we can say censorship is a struggle per se. Because censorship is another process that has like a starting point and an ending point. Something happens and then it gets censored. Or you write a piece of paper and then you censor yourself. Or somebody else coming and saying to you, now you're not allowed to say that. Or these different types of censorship. And I'm not sure if I would call all the examples we had on panel censorship. For example, some things that I've presented, they start from, let's say, common vandalism. So you vandalize or you don't agree with another position. So let's say in an ideal agonistic democratic space, you just don't agree and you go with your argument and say, I don't agree, I find this and this and this. But if you move to, you do the shift to the antagonism, so you have a struggle, like you have enemy relationship, enemy, so you consider the other part as an enemy and not as an adversary, and then the struggle starts to become more serious. So, and some at some point, for example, if you have like a war conflict, then it's not agonism, it's war. So it's conflict, it's like a, so I would like to differentiate all these different, it's like it's struggle, it's a big thing, but I would really go a little bit more focused what kind of conflict is happening. For example, if an art piece says this and this and this, and other people come to censor that or to impose their own opinions, or if it's like the Mavi Marmara case, or if it's like the foundation, the MEA, and so on. So it's, I think it's quite complicated too. But
yeah, just to add to that, I think the notion of conflict as something productive is what we're after, not so much about conflict for its own self, right? That's what we're talking about.
I think that censorship and conflict are different, and I do think that this panel was mostly about censorship, and I think that censorship is many times sort of an attempt to cover up for a failure of the system. Like if things ran smoothly, there wouldn't be a need for censorship. In papers, you used to say that the minute that editor-in-chief intervenes and prevents those rare occasions and prevents the publication of a piece that damages the interest or the political interest of the paper. And I was in a paper, Maariv, which used to do that more often than other papers, and especially in its last few years. I think, like, in a good paper, where everything functions normally, people internalize, and that's maybe goes back to the self-censorship, people internalize the spirit of the system so well that this need to censorship will not appear. So if you want to end with an optimistic note on what is happening now, and I do believe that in a sense that the increase in censorship in Israel, which I do believe exists, is because there's a multitude of narrative and a sort of breakdown, or at least a crisis in the dominant narrative that results in more powerful aggressive action.
Any more comments, questions? Came kind of late. I mean, for me, the optimistic point is this quote that Sofia brought of Etienne Balibar, that in the end, censorship is never going to settle in. It's always going to be fluid. It's going to change. It's external to our society and to our way of being, and it will always change and flow. So, if you want to say anything more, if not, I thank you all, Sofia, Chen, Noam, very much, Ruti, and Maayan for the amazing show. And I hope you all saw it. If not, you have to come back because it's closed now. So, thank you.